Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone, wherever you may be across the world. Well, thanks for joining us here live today for Serverless Office Hours, streaming live on AWS and Serverless Land. And yeah, thank you for joining us. My name is Julian Wood. I am a senior developer advocate for serverless here at AWS. And today I'm the lucky one. I get to be joined by the doyen of DevTools himself, Mr. Richard Boyd. And it's serverless surprise today. So there is, I will go through some of the things that we're doing on Serverless Land and the streaming series, but it's serverless surprise today. And we're going to be talking to one of the gurus of AWS Cloud9, Mr. Richard Boyd. So how are you doing today, Richard?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me, Julian. I appreciate the fine introduction. Really set the bar high. I have a big shoes to fill now.
not at all. You are the guru, so thank you for joining. Yeah, so strictly speaking, the first half is Richard dropping all his guru knowledge and showing us some cool stuff and building some cool things, and then we open up to your questions about Cloud9, AWS, or anything serverless in general, really. But to be honest, how it actually works is we love to take your questions all through the whole hour, and we are so happy to just have you join us. So yeah, I just want to pop in a few things to looking back at what's been happening with Serverless Office Hours. Last week's video has been posted up, so you can see the QR codes and the links below. Last week was to do with AWS messaging and events, and it was James Bezek, and it wasn't actually myself. I think it was Chris Munns who spoke about API destinations and X-Ray for Amazon EventBridge. Then what's new in AWS? These are the releases that have been happening, or new things that have been happening over the past week in AWS. So we've got two releases for AWS Amplify, data management one, and Amplify iOS, now available via the Swift package manager. And then EFS has got some new things. Step Functions has got a really good new data flow simulator. And my colleague Ben Smith is going to be talking about this in a few weeks' time. And this is really good to be able to visually see what you are building with your step function state machines. So yeah, really good. Amazon S3, one of the wonders of the modern IT world is Amazon S3. And so this is Control Tower, introduces some changes for preventative S3 guardrails. That's always a good thing. And in our more sort of serverless world, even AWS Lambda has CloudWatch Lambda Insights. So if you're not aware, CloudWatch Lambda Insights is a tool to give you even more visibility into your Lambda functions as they run. And now this supports adding them to Lambda functions that are packaged as container images. Some recent compute blog posts that have been written by our team and other people over AWS. In case you missed it, so all the posts we've had over Q1 for 2021, and there are a lot of them. So a really good way just to catch up on what's happening in serverless on AWS. James Bezig wrote that. Then some cool use cases, processing satellite imagery with serverless architectures by Justin. That's a good one. And also, if you're into API Gateway, evaluating access control methods to secure Amazon API Gateway APIs. And that's really useful, looking at doing some sort of opinionated information to look at the different access control methods you've got and how you can potentially use them. And then speaking about one of the big ones, talking about opinionated information, James Bezek is doing an amazing series on operating Lambda. It's called the Operating Lambda Guide, and this is being released partly in the documentation, and I'll show you that shortly. But there's also a whole set of blog posts. And yesterday, James released Operating Lambda and Isolating and Resolving Issues. So the isolating is not to do with isolating a Lambda function, but that's more how to do the troubleshooting to find out what's going on. And then the last blog post series, which is starting, which I'm also super excited about, is my colleague Ben Smith, who's doing a Getting Started for Serverless with Developers. Sorry, that's the other way around. Getting Started with Serverless for Developers. And this is really a 100 level one, helping you to understand serverless. It's all based in the IDE, so it's going to be a progressive app that's going to be developed. Start with nothing. You can just start in VS Code. And over the weeks, you'll be able to build up your serverless knowledge, and it doesn't assume you know anything. And it's a really nice, friendly way to understand what the heck the serverless things are, debug some of the myths that there actually are servers running in serverless, and yeah, just help you out to be able to start putting some things together. Let me have a drink of water before the frog in my throat completely kills me.
I've noticed that that Brian Bost has been writing a lot more blog posts lately. I think James Beswick's going to have some competition if Brian keeps this up.
Absolutely. And it's good stuff as well. I think James is the absolute blogging machine. So anyone who's going to chase his coattails is going to have their work cut out for them. But yeah, good on you, Brian. So I talked about James and his Lambda Operator's Guide. Here's the link over here. This is excellent because, as we know, with the AWS documentation, it's in a lot of different places because it's a lot of different services. And this is a really good way to look at the Lambda Operator's Guide. But then it drags in things about event-driven architectures and observability and performance optimization and grabs a whole lot of different parts of not only just documentation, with links to blog posts and videos and all kind of things. So if you are operating a serverless application, obviously Lambda is probably likely going to be at the heart of that. And so this is a really useful guide to be able to look through and find some really interesting information from, as you can see in the I've mentioned debugging, security, performance optimization, a whole bunch of things. This, you could literally spend hours going in here and pop in and pop back and forth and get some useful information. Last one, we're super excited. Our team has released the Serverless Patterns Collection. So if you are writing serverless applications, I know you are using AWS SAM, our infrastructure as code tool, or the CDK, the Cloud Development Kit. These are little snippets of code that you can grab off GitHub, and it allows you to connect two services together. So here we've got API Gateway and we've got Lambda, but things like Event Bridge to SNS or Lambda to SQS, all these kind of things. There's little nuggets of SAM and CDK code that you can scratch your head hunting the interwebs for, copying and pasting. This is a great resource to find out all the information about those things. And last thing, we've got something called Serverless Live. So this is coming up on May the 9th. And this is a serverless subject matter experts, a full virtual day of technical deep dives, demos, and more. And you can register now at that link. So today we're talking about Serverless Surprise, and we're talking AWS Cloud9. And as I mentioned, I'm Julian Wood, and we've got Richard Boyd. There are contact details on Twitter. Both of us are senior developer advocates. We work in slightly different organizations, but today we're still talking about serverless kind of things. So Richard, over to you.
Awesome. Thanks, Julian. My name's Richard Boyd. I focus on developer tools, which covers our Cloud9, our IDEs and our toolkits, AWS Toolkit for VS Code, the Toolkit for Cloud9, as well as our code suite and our SDK, CDK, CLI. But today we're going to talk about Cloud9, specifically on the collaborative coding feature, so how you can pair program and work remotely with other people, as well as a recent addition to Cloud9 that allows you to use an Amazon Linux 2 image so that you can avoid any hassle with cross-compiling when you are trying to build Lambda functions that rely on compiled languages, and even on some interpreter languages such as Python that have compiled components to it. So if you've ever tried to deploy a Lambda function that used Pandas or NumPy or SciPy, those have compiled, I believe, C++ bindings for those that you either need to use a Docker container or I think years ago, before there was really good Docker support in SAM CLI, the recommended approach was to spin up an EC2 instance with the Amazon Linux AMI on it, and then compile the stuff there, and then like zip it up, pull it locally, zip it up again with your function code, and then put it in the Lambda. And the tooling has improved like significantly over the past 3 years, 4 years, however long it's been since it started. People don't have to do that. So Docker addresses most of this, but there are still some areas where people still have to cross-compile. So with Cloud9 supporting Amazon Linux 2 natively now, that's the operating system that Lambda uses, under the Lambda service uses under the hood, you don't have to worry about any cross-compiling. You know that the operating systems will be compatible. So we're going to go through a quick demo, show how that's used today as well.
Perfect. So, Richard, can we just take a step back, please? And if don't know what Cloud9 is, can you just give an overview of Cloud9 before we show the magic?
Yeah. So, Cloud9 is AWS's cloud-based IDE. So, the very high-level concept is that you, from a browser, you navigate to a URL, and it is connected to this compute backend. So, it's for Cloud9, it's an EC2 instance, and the EC2 instance does all like the heavy computation that's needed for the actual IDE, the IDE's compute environment. And then Cloud9 also acts as the front end IDE in front of that gives you your syntax highlighting and tab completion and some of the other developer ergonomic features that you'd expect from an IDE.
Excellent. So it's a full IDE in the cloud. You don't need anything local other than a browser just to connect to it. And there, obviously, if you think of it, if you've got your local workstation, you need a lot of power, you need a lot of oomph, you maybe need a lot of network bandwidth to be able to run whatever you're going to be doing. This is basically a developer-focused EC2 instance in the cloud. Connect to it via browser, all available via the AWS console. Super easy to use, and you can obviously add as much resources as you can throw at it, obviously within the limits of EC2. But I know, Eric Johnson's not on the Twitch stream today, and he's got this massive EC2 Cloud9 instance, and so he runs all of his packaging and all of his things over there, and he doesn't need to bog down his local machine. So yeah, super useful.
Yeah, and before the coronavirus COVID situation kicked off, when we were traveling a lot more, I would use my iPad, the just regular Chrome browser on my iPad, and I could. I think I'd benchmarked it at one point where I could build a 600 megabyte Docker container from my iPad in just a few seconds, because the actual EC2 instance is running like in the AWS data center. So when you do like Docker pull to pull some image, it only has to pull it to that EC2 instance. So it doesn't have to pull it all the way to your end user device. So I should mention, I was also on a plane when I did that. So I was using like the plane Wi-Fi at like 32 kilobits per second or whatever they actually give you, regardless of what they say they're going to sell you. So I could build like these huge Docker images on an iPad at 30,000 feet by using this cloud-based IDE environment.
Fantastic. And I can attest to it. I remember doing some Docker work, I think 5 or 6 years ago, and I was learning Docker, and I was actually pulling down a Docker image on the way to DockerCon in Seattle. And I was on a plane, and that was the slowest, most ridiculous, most ridiculous thing I could have thought of. So yeah, and one other thing I like about Cloud9 is because they're so sort of easy to set up, you can set up multiple of them. So you could have different Cloud9 instances for different projects you may work on. And you know, some people are multilingual, and they may be working on different, or for different business units or different languages, and they need a whole bunch of different dependencies. So yeah, just have different Cloud9 instances. You can shut them down when you're not using them, so you're not obviously paying for them to be up and running all the time. And it's really easy to switch between multiple ones of them. So that's also another use case to have multiple Cloud9 instances at your beck and call.
Yeah, and that's what, especially if you're a polyglot developer, if you're developing a lot of languages, typically each language has like its own like isolation mechanism. So Python, you've got like PyEnv and virtual environments, and I assume Java has something like that. JavaScript has like its own isolation mechanisms, but with Cloud9, you can have these multiple environments that are set up. That each one is specific to a specific tool you're working on or a language that you're using, and it really like solidifies the boundary between these two projects. So you don't have to worry about over like resource contention or any kind of overlap or dependencies from one interacting with another. And when you create it through the CLI or through the console, it'll ask you. There's a parameter called the automatic shutdown timeout, I believe is the name of the parameter. And it's basically like how long do you want it to be idle before it shuts itself down? So you could say never and just leave it on all the time if someone else is paying your EC2 bill. Or you could say 30 minutes, and when the connection goes idle, it'll shut down the instance for you. So you only have to pay for it while you're using it. And when you come back, you restart the instance, the EBS volume's loaded back up, and you pick up right where you left off.
Yeah, super useful.
Cool. I'll hop into a demo real quick.
Oh, that sounds great. That's what we're all about. Cool. Yeah. Oh, wrong screen. Switch over to Mr. Boyd.
There is a question in the chat. I'm not sure if I'm supposed to be reading the chat, but someone asked, how does Cloud9 differ from Cloud Shell? So Cloud9 is, as we see here, it's an IDE. It's a full-featured IDE. Oh, cool. There's a feature to show it on the screen. It's a full-featured IDE, like in the cloud. You can render, you run like a Node.js server on this and then connect to it to see like how your website's going to look. Cloud Shell is a bash shell in the cloud. It's a command line in the cloud. So its functionality is much more limited than Cloud9, but it's also, it's embedded in the browser. I'll just show it real quick. Let me just, nope, that's not what I wanted. So Cloud Shell is a CLI in the browser. It's the first time I use it in this account, so it's gonna spin up. And this allows you to run CLI commands. So if you wanted to list all of your buckets, you wanted to list the versions of your Lambda functions that you had, if you wanted to clean up some older ones, typically there's a kind of a dance you have to do about logging into one account, assume a role in that account, use those credentials to sign a request to list some resource, do some stuff, assume a role in another account. Cloud Shell allows you to do that kind of graphically. These are typically ops-related tasks that are done one-off or more exploratory, where it's not as easy to do from the CLI, where you really want that the context of the console there with you to kind of help guide what you're looking at, what you're looking for.
Excellent. Just Richard, while you are there, can any chance of just upping the font?
Oh yeah, yeah, definitely.
Thank you. So thank you. Any other questions over here? Is there a timeline for Cloud9 instances to migrate to AWS CLI 2?
Yes. is this still on version 1? I'm not sure about an actual timeline. So we are working on migrating to AWS CLI v2 for Cloud9 as we update the underlying Omni for it. We are cognizant, like there are people who've been using Cloud9 for a while who have a bunch of scripts that are set up that just use an AWS command, and they're expecting AWS CLI v1. So if we just bump the version and push it out, it could break like existing automation that people have in place. So we're working on a way to make that a bit more seamless and pain-free, for our customers.
And also remember, this is only on initial running of the first AWS Cloud9. So you can upgrade the CLI yourself, and then that Cloud9 instance is baked with that CLI until you get rid of it. So this is only on creation of new environments. And there was also a question about SAM CLI. That's exactly the same kind of thing. SAM CLI is going to lag a bit behind, but there's absolutely no reason that you can't just upgrade it yourself, and then you're off to the races, and you can go and once you shut that down that and comes back up, it's going to then have the AWS CLI v2 or SAM CLI version that you've got.
Yeah, and these are these are the defaults that once you have the environment, you can customize however you want.
And here's a good point that somebody else mentioned, Doug Toppin. Private subsets presume that subnets are also an advantage for companies that don't allow any risk of external access. So you're not having to SSH into some kind of things or do anything like kind of that, as it's purely browser based and limited to what you can do in the AWS console. This is also another helpful advantage to Cloud9.
Yeah, and I think what Doug was getting at is when you create an environment, skip this and the next step, it'll ask you the type that you want. So what I call like the legacy Cloud9 that AWS has is this EC2 instance environment. So what this does is when you create this, it will create a security group for the EC2 instance that allows port 22 access from an IP address that is like publicly known to be associated with the AWS Cloud9 service. And that's how the connection happens. But you still need to open up that port. A lot of customers, especially in highly regulated industries, aren't comfortable with that. So last June, we launched this new, we call it no ingress EC2 instance, which uses System Manager. So you can have a security group that allows no inbound access whatsoever. And you can also do no egress, no outbound access, but it's a bit trickier. You can force traffic through specific outbound, like data exfiltration protection tools that are offered by third-party partners, or you can run it through NAT gateways or other things for monitoring your traffic. And this allows like full isolated instances so that it's only connected to via Systems Manager, and it provides a much more secure footprint for your cloud computing infrastructure. And then this is an older one where you could connect it to anything that accepts an SSH connection. So you could run Cloud9 on a Raspberry Pi. Not that I would recommend that, but you could do that here if it had a publicly available IP address and had SSH open. Cool. I think we're set. We did launch just, trying to remember exactly when we launched it. I think it was just before reInvent. Maybe somewhere around reInvent. All of the months around reInvent kind of blend together with preparing for a launch and then cleaning up immediately after a launch. I forget exactly when this launched, but there is this AWS Explorer, which is part of the AWS Toolkit for Cloud9 that we launched, that allows you to explore resources that you have. This is a SAM app that I deployed earlier just so that there'd be stuff in here. And it shows you resources that you have in this account, this region that I had specified you as supporting. And we can, you know, invoke this function. You can pick, these are the same invocation events that you would see in the AWS Lambda console for a function. So a common, you know, API gateway authorizer, not the authorizer, proxy. This looks very familiar. If you've used that console before, you see like the body request, path, query strings, et cetera. And you can kind of invoke the function. And this is what you normally see in CloudWatch logs or in the console itself when it comes back. So this allows you to interact with your Lambda functions while they're deployed in the cloud, instead of trying to simulate a function locally and then upload it to the cloud, stage it, deploy it, and then hope that you have the same actions. It's not the right word. The same behavior once it is deployed. This allows you to have a more higher fidelity environment for testing your functions from your cloud IDE, testing the actual deployed Lambda function.
Perfect. So this is also similar functionality to the AWS Toolkit for Visual Studio Code, but obviously, because you're not running it locally for Visual Studio Code, this is an equivalent within Cloud9.
Correct. Yep. Very similar. And we also have the AWS Toolkit for JetBrains, which covers IntelliJ and PyCharm and CLion and Rider and the whole suite from JetBrains.
Yeah, so definitely if you are developing with AWS, be it Cloud9 or JetBrains, IntelliJ, Visual Studio Code, the AWS Toolkit 4X is super useful.
Yes, exactly. Thanks. And so my one thing I like is that we recently announced Amazon Linux 2 support for Cloud9. And like I had mentioned earlier, this prevents the need for like cross-compiling. So I'm going to go through just a quick demo of kind of like how this would work. So if we wanted to deploy a Lambda function that was backed, that uses Rust as the runtime for it. So it's a Rust-based Lambda function. So there's a couple ways to start it. My personal favorite is I use the SAM CLI to just generate like a random, you know, maybe a Python SAM template, and then I strip out all the Python bits and then replace them with Rust bits. If you were someone like Eric Johnson or James Beswick, maybe you could kind of do it from scratch without having to use a template, but I like to use the templates. So I just say Sam. Exactly, us commoners. Sam init, I think that's, yep. We'll say we want a quick start template. The zip, we're gonna use a zip artifact. We're not gonna package it up into a Docker image for the language. This part isn't too important because we're just gonna pull it out, but I'm just gonna say Python 3.7 just to be going. And then we'll just call it our Rust app. Gonna clone it in a simple hello world. And here we have it in the Rust app. And this is the template if anyone's used the SAM CLI before. This all looks familiar. I always remove all of these outputs when I start because what I end up doing is I will remove some parts like the API or some other part, and I'll forget to remove the output section, and I'll deploy it and then it'll fail because it's the output's still deploying a thing that I deleted. So I delete this and then I manually re-add it if I need something.
Any chance of just getting some bigger fonts on there, please?
For us
older people in the back. No, that it always happens.
Okay. Global function timeout is 30. Now for runtime, we're going to use the provided runtime, provided AL. And handler, for the provided runtimes, the handler doesn't matter because it's hard-coded to be this specific bootstrap.sh file. So you could put anything in here. So just to demonstrate, you can just say this does not matter, right? You literally put whatever you want. There has to be a value there for the API's compatibility mechanisms for the for CloudFormation for the macro. And for the code URI, I'm just going to say it's this current directory. And I'm going to delete the events. Don't tell anyone I deleted these tests. And the init, I can probably delete that too. Okay, now I want to move this up. Can I make this? Nope, this is where it gets weird. Not letting me make this bigger. Here we go. Okay. Actually. Okay. Trying to remember the text off the top of my head. So I need to see the end of here, make sure I'm in there. And cargo new my app. And create a new binary called my app. And now what we need to do is we need to, which should be, I think, a very simple like hello world application. What we need to do is we need to, two parts. We need to create an application that understands the what the Lambda invocation model looks like. So when the Lambda service invokes a function, it will send it some payload, and we need some way of processing that. So we're going to use the Rust Lambda, Lambda runtime. I think I have those words. Some combination of those three words is the name of this thing, which we'll get to in just a moment. And then once we have that, we need to package this up in a way that the Lambda service understands it so that it can deploy the function and invoke the function correctly. So we will start with the packaging mechanism.
You've used a provided Lambda, provided runtime, not AL2, correct, for this one?
Yes, I specified.
Okay. Yep. Yeah. So for people who are not aware, there's sort of two flavors currently of Amazon Linux and Amazon Linux 2. And, a number of the Lambda function languages that come with Amazon Linux are, for instance, Java 8, but then Java 8 Coreto and Java 11 Coreto is Amazon Linux 2. Go is Amazon Linux, not Amazon Linux 2. Then Ruby 2.7 is Amazon Linux 2. Python 3.8 and onwards is Amazon Linux 2. And then Node.js 10 and upwards is Amazon Linux 2. So anything before that would be normal previous Amazon Linux. And then if you're doing Node, for example, 10, 12, and 14 is Amazon Linux 2. And what Richard is going through as well is the custom runtime. So the custom runtime, we've got a whole bunch of our languages that we support, like the .NET and Go and Java, Ruby, Python, Node, something else. There are probably some others. Custom runtimes mean you can bring any language to Lambda. And as Richard was saying, there's a little bit of extra code you've got to add to your function to be able to interact between your code and the Lambda service.
Yep. And we're going to, right now I'm going to go over the kind of how you package up your Lambda function to make it available in this context. So the first thing we need to do is we will add this, what's called a metadata. I'm gonna zoom this out a bit. So in our template, we supply for the function, we supply a metadata where we say the build method that the SAM CLI should use is this makefile method. And then we will create a makefile. What can be confusing is that here the M is lowercase. I'm not sure like how required that is, but for your actual makefile, it has to be uppercase for the M in makefile. Otherwise, it won't find it. It won't work correctly. And once we have this makefile, we are going to tell it how to make our application. And this is where it can get tricky. So this is an issue with the makefile syntax itself. Cloud9 tries to be helpful, and you can say anytime I press a tab, replace it with some number of spaces, or vice versa, depending on which side of that argument you're on, whether you like spaces or that you're wrong. But the makefile insists that they are tabs. So I just backspace these out and explicitly put in a tab. So if I copy and paste them in, it's not going to helpfully try to replace those. And I think I have to rename this. I think so. I'm pretty sure. So that's going to tell, let me reopen that. This is going to tell the SAM CLI how to make our function to package it up. And then, all right. Yeah, I'm going to pull these two files out of, when I ran cargo new inside of this folder, it kind of nested them inside of another application. I'm just going to pull these out so that they are kind of at the parent directory of where they were, and I will delete the old folder. And so I think this should work, and that it should compile. So if I run sam build, No such file. Why didn't that build? All right. So the reason this didn't build is because we have to tell Cargo and Rust like how to build our application, which we do by updating the Cargo file with this. So this says when it builds the binary, name it Bootstrap, and where to find this is this source/main RS. This is very common for binaries Rust. Fingers crossed this should work. Okay, so that built something. We show hidden files. Anytime you run SAM build, it'll put it inside this hidden folder. We'll see this build. And this is our Bootstrap file. This file will probably fail because I don't think we actually made any changes to it. It's just a hello world thing. It just prints hello world. So if we deploy this right now, it wouldn't work because it's going to get this like JSON blob when it's invoked by the Lambda function, and it's going to just print something and then just be done. And the Lambda service is going to expect back from the function some kind of a JSON body as a response. Now, if you were very clever and much smarter than me, you could figure out what that invocation object looks like, parse it, do whatever you need to do, and then construct a proper response object that the Lambda service will understand. I'm not nearly that smart. So what I do is I use the Lambda Rust runtime. Let me see if I can find this.
So again, this is specific because you're using custom runtimes, and you obviously, there's a translation layer between your code and the Lambda service, and the Lambda service is going to send JSON to you. You've got to send JSON back. But this is sort of kind of the work you need to do to get your custom runtimes working. If you're using Node, Python, or whatever the kind of runtimes, this is all handled for you behind the scenes.
Exactly. Yeah. If you're using one of the managed runtimes, like for Python, you can just return an arbitrary JSON object, and the Lambda service knows how to handle that and marshal that back to you, escaping strings and doing whatever it needs to do. What we're doing here is similar, like if you've used TypeScript or JavaScript before, we use frameworks to render elements in the DOM or do all these very low-level manipulation things. You could, if you want to, like roll your own thing that's a light version of React, or you could just use a framework that does it for you. I would describe this as like a framework for interacting with the Lambda service from the perspective of the function that's running inside the Lambda service. So this is the runtime that shows an example of kind of the invocation. The main is the function that's always invoked. It's similar to C++ and C.
Can we zoom into
a bit? Thanks.
Thank you.
So we see it's the main function. It's asynchronous using the Tokyo, which is the Rust asynchronous library. And typically the pattern that's shown is that there's this main function that immediately just calls into some other function, which is your actual logic. And then when that function returns, it just like returns the value. This one, I think, returns nothing. It just says, done, like a success code. I do want to leave time for questions in the chat because I saw there's quite a few. So I'm not going to actually go through the rest of the building out the Rust runtime and deploying this and testing it, because that'll easily take the whole rest of our hour. And I saw there's a lot of questions in the chat. So we can stop here if you want and go to the Q&A.
Sure. Let's continue.
It's up to the people in the chat.
We'll do a quick with a thank you, first of all, for all your questions. And I'm going to inject some now because I'm going to forget them by the time I'm going to forget the position in the queue where we're doing. So there was some conversation about for Node.js 14, for SAM CLI, a few different kind of things about SAM CLI, that the SAM CLI does not support Node.js 14. The SAM CLI does support Node.js 14. It may not just be in the quick start templates. I don't have one to particularly look at, but basically what SAM is doing is it's doing a CloudFormation transformation, and it's fully aware of Node.js 14. So AlphaCode says he is working, or she is working on Node.js 14 with SAM CLI on Cloud9 and no issues. Simply, it's within your template.yaml file. You can just do you can just do put Node.js 14. Any of the supported runtimes are work quite well in work quite well with SAM.
There was one other question where someone asked, "Does Cloud9 keep my code so that I can exit and come back where I left off?" That is true. So the code is persisted to an EBS volume on the EC2 instance. That will persist it by itself. There's also the Git plugin on the left-hand side, just above the AWS Explorer, that allows you to create a repository, push it to that repository, so that repository can be code commit, GitHub, GitHub Enterprise, Bitbucket, GitLab, any kind of Git repository that you want to connect to. If you want like truly persistent long-term storage of your code, or you want to pull that, if you wanted to say the machine that I'm using now isn't quite big enough, let me push my code to Git, create a new environment and pull it back down and build on this bigger environment. So yes, it does allow you to. There's a couple of different mechanisms for persisting that code across sessions, but it will persist it if you're just in the environment. It times out, the instance shuts down. There is a very small caveat, which is you just have to have internet access when you're done editing it. So the files will periodically sync, but if whatever reason, say you're on an iPad and you lose all of your internet access, anything you do locally won't be backed up to the cloud. And those changes could be lost, but that's only in cases where you have intermittent or unreliable internet access. And you will know if your code has been synced if you save. You'll see this green dot that appears showing that it's saved. When you make a change to a file, you see a gray dot appears. That means what you have is different than what's on the server, like in the cloud. And if this dot turns red, it means there's no internet access for it to sync those two when you try to save it. So that's how you would know if for whatever reason the file wasn't synced. But in general, yes, it will save your code.
Thanks. Yeah, quick other question. What about Docker in Lambda? So when SAM CLI, depending on what the question actually is, when SAM CLI is doing a local invoke for testing, that is using Docker for Lambda, local Lambda testing. Lambda can also have functions packaged as container images. So that's not quite Docker. So yeah, I'm not quite sure what the question is, but there are a few sort of Docker and Lambda integration points to talk about. And then there are some talk about plugins for, of course, I've lost the, what plugins does Cloud9 support? Does it allow users to develop their own plugins?
Today it does. We have the way we've built the AWS toolkit for Cloud9 is like a plugin, and we're working on making that functionality more generic so that people can bring their own plugins, or you can, do this. For what exists today, there is no functionality for defining an arbitrary plugin or bringing specific plugins. We have heard this feedback quite often, and it is a thing that we're working on.
Yeah, and similar for the AWS Toolkit for Visual Studio Code. I know your team's working super hard to add more and more functionality all the time. So yeah, keep your eyes peeled. These kind of things will hopefully be coming shortly.
Yeah, and this is what the reference to helper codes is, that the two toolkits aren't in sync. There isn't feature parity between those two today. We are working towards an automated mechanism for providing feature parity between both of those as new features are released. That is a thing that we're working on. I just don't have a timeline or a date for it. A couple people saying hi, Jay Walsh to me. Greetings from to Chicago. Someone from Germany, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thank you for everyone.
Are there any?
Yeah, just to pick up this one from Alpa Codes, who's being super useful answering questions. Thank you very much. When you run out of disk space, Cloud9 does show you a warning, and there's a very easy script that you can run, and that just increases the EBS volume and job done. So that's really easy. I'll try and drag out the link for that. It's in the documentation, but yeah, quite simple to use.
Yeah, I use that. I generally have that bookmarked. I usually know that because it's purple, because I go to it all the time. So I will put that in the chat.
And just, yeah, before we've gone, the pair programming is Cloud9 built specifically for writing Lambda functions, other use cases as well. It has any use case that you want to have a development machine within the cloud. Obviously, it's great for doing Lambda, and as Richard explaining, using packaging things for Amazon Linux 2 now, that's the new use case. But yeah, Cloud9 can be used for anything.
I just want to make sure I don't skip anyone. Does Cloud9 need IAM roles to access resources on the AWS account, or does the role of the user, use the role of the user to access resources? The answer is it does both. So the way this works, I can show you quickly what as like a demo. So if I say AWS STS get caller identity, I misspelled STS. Don't tell anyone that. Eric will never let me forget it. So this shows that it's my, I have this thing that allows me to like federate access into my account. So I call it federate as like a stupid pun that I giggle every time I see it. So this is the role that I use to have access to my, the actual console itself. So this is using my console credentials. So the same credentials I would use when I'm interacting with Cloud Shell, or I'm trying to create a new environment, or I'm looking at buckets. You're also able to go into preferences and turn off what we call manage credentials. And then I will refresh this. And if I run that same command again, it's now using the instance profile for the environment. So you can tell it to use the instance profile that's attached to the EC2 instance, or you can tell it to use kind of your identity as the console user, based on whatever works well for you. We've seen some people say, well, instance profile is just for management activities that we run kind of at the enterprise level to keep the instances up to date. Individual developers shouldn't be using that. So then everyone's forced to use the managed temporary credentials. And I've seen arguments for the other direction of they'd rather just a single set of credentials, which is a managed, which is the instance profile credentials. The right answer is it depends based on what your use case is.
Thanks. Yeah, I think we'll have a pause for the questions just to get to the, I know the excited part about the pair programming. But yeah,
oh, right,
send your questions through. We will continue.
Oh, I agree.
We will carry on with the questions. Richard's got so excited about Cloud9, and he's forgetting all the cool stuff he can show.
Why isn't this working? Sorry. So I made this thing that allows me to easily share the environment. There's a Python 3 attack. Oh, wait, I don't think it's dash M. I'm so nervous I forgot syntax. And then I'm going to share with Julian. Oh, no. Oh, it's because I turned these off.
So what is, can you just talk about the use cases for why you may want to share a Cloud9 instance? Obviously, you know, pair programming is one kind of thing, but, you know, developers would normally have their own workstations. So what are the use cases that you see are interesting for using Cloud9?
For the pair programming or just in general?
And in general.
There's quite a few, depending on who. So a very popular use case for it, CS50 has been vocal about using this even before the acquisition, that they used it because it allows you to create an environment that you can very quickly spin up an environment that's identical each time. So for people getting started, if you've run kind of workshops or you've done like training sessions, everyone brings their own laptop. They might have a Windows machine or a Linux machine or a MacBook or any other type of device, that trying to get everyone on the same page in terms of what their environment looks like so that they can all follow along for the lecture. You'll spend three times as much time working on just getting the environment set up as you would for the students to learn, which is an effective use of either the student's time or the instructor's time. So Cloud9 does, it gives you this repeatable mechanism for creating these environments so that everyone starts on the same page. It's very easy to automate and script. The same kind of mechanism is great for enterprise customers, because when a new developer starts, you can say, okay, here is your development environment. It has all of our best practices baked in. It has all, you know, it's in the right region. It has our software that we need already installed on it. You're ready to go without having to worry about, you know, mailing a physical machine to a headquarters, having it imaged, packaging it up, mailing it out to the developer. Things like that. So, and because these Cloud9 instances are all run in EC2 instances, they're inside the VPC. You can be very confident the data is not going to leave that VPC. It's not going to leave that data center. So you don't have to worry about, you know, if you developers, you know, sitting in a park doing their stuff. They aren't paying attention. Someone steals their laptop. Hopefully you have full disk encryption, but if you don't have full disk encryption, now someone has all of your data because they found it on some developer's laptop. So it creates a more secure posture for your development environment.
Okay.
Sorry, I just gotta set the region. Okay, try this. Okay, so I'm gonna send this link to. Hopefully I cleared that before anyone was able to copy it.
Some very fast speed readers.
Exactly. I was more worried about someone screenshotting it. Now, there we go. And I just sent it to Julian via our, you know, kind of company chat app. And this will allow him to share the environment with me, hopefully, if I set it up correctly.
Hopefully. Waiting for the interwebs to come. Yeah, we were trying this yesterday, and we were having all loads of fun with our chat app mangling something up with the URL. He says that, and then I think I've got a space. Well, the cool thing is I'm actually going to share my screen quickly because what I've done is I've literally opened the link. So all I did is I pasted the link over there. I haven't had to log in. I haven't had to do anything. I haven't had to give a name, even though Richard created for a name, Julian. This is literally just a URL link, and I'm straight in.
Mine, I can see that Julian joined the environment. I can see where it's. So this is me, the F, because I'm using that federate role. I'm not sure why this says M. But show active files. So this will show me what Julian's. Oh, Julian has this. He has a terminal open. So if Julian, if you want to just open up any file you want or make any changes, however you want, and then I'll show where I can see that on my side.
Cool. Well, I will show it from my side. So I've just flipped over to my screen. You can't sort of see that, obviously. But then, you know, Richard's been working on this Rust app. I have got full visibility into this. I can open all the applications. So I mean, yeah. Rust app for Richard's awesome project. So I can just save that. And yeah, if we jump back to Richard's, so that was the readme. Let's see. Ah, so Richard's got a notification to say that that's been updated.
Yeah, so it'll show I can go to the active file. So this is the file that Julian has active, and it shows this purple line. It corresponds to color for his avatar of this is the thing that Julian added to the file. So this allows us what's commonly described in the Cloud IDE community is what they call pushing pixels. If you ever try to debug with someone else, like over the phone or video chat, where one person has a screen open and another person's, and that person's sharing their screen, another person, okay, scroll up. No, scroll up. Oh, wait, stop. Scroll back down. Okay, right there. That's frustrating for like both sides because you have to, as you're trying to figure out, you know, where a bug is or where a change needs to be made, you have to then communicate like each individual browser action to do to the person, you know, scroll up to this thing, go to this method, jump to this. With this type of collaboration, Julian can go and look at it, you know, try to test a bunch of hypotheses, say like, oh, is it this file? Like how's this supposed to look without asking me to manually navigate to all these things where I'm just kind of taken along for the ride and he's telling me to jump all over the place. And it also allows Julian to do things like the, you know, command click to follow a method to its definition and using, you know, real proper IDE-based tools. So it's this type of collaboration is generally considered more developer-friendly than what we call pushing pixels, where you're just sharing a screen with all of the stuff. It also has this group chat. In this context, it's not super useful because Julian and I are on a phone call, so we can just talk to each other, but I can also just like add a message here and then Julian will see it on his side.
Excellent.
And this also shows me, you know, all of the files that Julian has open and the one that he currently has highlighted. So I can see that he has the template file kind of open in the context view on his
I love that. So I mean, there's just so many use cases that bubble up into my mind. Obviously, even, you know, programmers within the same team or the same organization being able to iterate, not just on the same code base, but the same environment. Somebody does a Git pull, somebody does a test, something's going strange. Well, it works on my laptop. Well, here we go. Jump into mine. You can see it. That's great. I can think of support use cases. Okay, we're talking about developers here and developing Lambda functions. But, you know, this is as Cloud9 is a super secure way within a VPC that you can access your resources. If you've got a third party who needs to do some troubleshooting with something, I mean, this could be anything on EC2, could be anything on RDS, or something with a third party common off the shelf software that they've installed. This is also a secure way that you could invite them into a Cloud9 instance that you could lock down and use that for support processes. You can see what they're doing. When you can see the file they're working on, it's like, no, it's not that template.yaml file, it's this one. So I can certainly see use cases for opening this up to the outside world to be able to help you do some troubleshooting, or something's gone boom in the night and you don't want to be hassling around trying to get somebody access.
Yep. That's a bit much more succinct description than I could have done.
It wasn't succinct, but I got there in the end. just a question about from Alpha Codes again. Any thoughts on when to use native Cloud9 versus VS Code with remote plugin connecting to a Cloud9 instance?
You could do this. I've done this before where I want to run kind of a couple of different IDEs next to each other. For example, if I want to, I like using VS Code for like JavaScript, TypeScript based applications, which is great for front end applications. They're almost always written in JavaScript. And then the back end will be written in Rust or Python or Java. So I will use Cloud9 IDE to do my Rust or Java or Python development. And I will have on my local machine, VS Code remote connecting to the code server tool that's installed on the EC2 instance with a port open. It's a slightly less secure configuration that way because you have to open up the port to allow your machine to directly connect to it. I'm at my house, so my IP address changes. So I have to, every time I start that, I have to kind of refresh the IP address that's allowed to punch through the security, it's authorized through the security group to connect to it. So it is possible. It's kind of clunky, but there are use cases where you'd want to use either one or both at the same time. So it's definitely not like, I wouldn't say it's highly discouraged, or it's certainly not bad in all cases. It's just something to, there are many things to take into consideration when you decide to go that route of having multiple IDEs sitting in front of the same compute environment.
Excellent. Do you have anything else specifically you want to show, or should we jump to some more questions?
That's all I have for now. We answer questions.
Excellent. So there was just one about the AWS Toolkit, or the features differ from VS Code to JetBrains products.
I think so. I think that some of this is based on the APIs that each support. So VS Code has its own kind of API for how the plugin model works. JetBrains has its own API. There is some work being done by the Eclipse Foundation to hopefully standardize what this API for extensions and IDEs looks like. So we should be able to see kind of the industry as a whole congeal around a specific set, similar to the way Docker did for containers. I think looking forward the next 3 to 5 years, we'll probably see that standardizing. So there wouldn't be a technical reason why all toolkits extensions couldn't have the same compatibility across all these IDEs. It's just today, it's a strictly technical reason of the APIs just aren't compatible.
Excellent. EDJ Geek, Eric Johnson, has been answering plenty of questions. I thank you, Eric, for jumping on.
Someone asked for in IDE step and breakpoints. Yeah, there is a very rich debugging feature we didn't get to today, but yes, it does have. Let me try and see how it's going. That's fine. Let me make it smaller. Generally, there's a debugger. I don't have it set up right now. So if you're using, it's definitely possible with Python and JavaScript to set breakpoints. It's as simple as just clicking on the line. I mean, this is a YAML file, so there is no breakpoints, but let me open up the source. I want this one. here we go. You could set a breakpoint here, and it applies this when you're in like the debug mode. So it does have a NID breakpoint step capability.
So Eric's just jumping in to clarify. This is specific to Java or .NET.
I think for Java, I don't think we have that today, but we are working on improving the Java experience via a plugin addition to the AWS Toolkit for Cloud9. I can't remember off the top of my head what the debug experience for Java looks like on Cloud9. I know it's not delightful, right, which makes me hesitant to say that it's even there, because I don't want people saying, Richard said it's there, let's go use it. And then it's not a great experience. The product manager for Cloud9 is probably yelling at me for saying that, but we do know that is a rough edge, and we are working on making that better.
Yeah. Quick one. Are Jupyter notebooks supported out of the box?
They are not. We've heard this feedback a few times, and we are working on better ways of supporting Jupyter notebooks. I think you can get them working, but it's not the rich like rendering experience that you get using it in like a Jupyter server. You can run like a Jupyter server on there, and it redirects you to a local URL for that works. It does take a little bit of tweaking, and it does work, but it's not a one-click turnkey experience that I'd love to see us offer for customers. Okay.
Just literally 30 seconds, anything you want to talk about that people should be excited about in the future, or any plans or anything that you can talk about? We don't need to have the list of everything that's coming out for Cloud9, although I'm sure people would love to.
We are working on making Cloud9 easier for, we recognize that there's this issue with, we create the instance for you, the EC2 instance for you, and manage it for you. Once we create it, you are then responsible for kind of keeping it patched, keeping it up to date. That works well for like most customers, but it's not great for it, like any individual customer. So we are working on what additional product offerings can we do to target customers who want a thing that's fully managed, like completely. I've heard some people make the reference of like serverless Cloud9. I don't think that's quite the right approach, but something along that line, fully managed Cloud9. And then the other extreme, which is let me bring my own compute. Let me bring my entire own compute. Let me completely specify my own EC2 instance, all my settings, and then just connect Cloud9 to that. That's the direction I'm trying to push the Cloud9 team in, to be more opinionated and offer slightly separate products in these spaces to be a great experience for two different sets of people, as opposed to what we have today, which is like kind of good for everybody, but not great for anyone specifically.
Yeah. Richard, well, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate you taking the time and showing us some cool demos for the Amazon Linux 2 and for the shared programming, and answering plenty of tips and tricks. Thank you again so much. There's Richard's contact details. Anything else that you'd like to mention about contact or anything?
No, I mean, you can at me on Twitter. If you have any comments, thanks for having me. I appreciate the time and sharing this with the serverless community.
Absolute pleasure. And up in Serverless Office Hours next week, as I was talking about at the beginning, James Bezik's amazing Lambda Operators Guide. So as we go on the series, well, we've got all the weeks. I'll show that shortly. The Lambda Operator Guide, James Bezik's going to go deep into detail for that. This is what's coming up over the next few weeks. As you can see, we've done Cloud9 today, Lambda Operators Guide coming up. We then iterate through step functions, API gateway, and API messaging. So this is the flow that we'll be going through over the weeks, and that's what's coming up. So join us on the links above. And of course, for anything serverless related, head over to serverlessland.com, and we've got blogs, tips, tricks, videos, learning paths, everything to do with serverless on AWS. Thank you so much for watching. Please join us next week. And if you're watching from this recording or have any questions or anything you want to get hold of us, and we'd love to help you on your serverless journey. Have a great day.